Hi, I'm Matthew Wilder.
We were a family of four, my parents, my brother, and I. I was born in New York and raised in the safe, conservative suburb of Long Island till I was 14 years old. That's when my world was turned upside down. My parents told me we were moving to Manhattan, to Greenwich Village. The year was 1967, and I was torn away from the only world I had ever known, never to see my house or my friends ever again. My brother went off to college. I became an only child overnight and didn't know a soul. So I spent endless hours walking the streets of New York, my new backyard, Washington Square Park, the Village. I attended a high school in Harlem. It took me 3 subway trains to commute to the 60s revolution. It was the turbulent time of assassinations and demonstrations, the draft, and the war in Vietnam. Music was my only refuge, and it saved my life. I began performing in the streets and the local clubs where the folk scene was born, the home of Bob Dylan, Joni Mitchell, James Taylor. This is where it all began. I wrote my first song when I was 16, discovered performing on the street, flown to Los Angeles to record my first album, to begin the life of a touring musician. I was 19 years old.
I know that's a lot of information to take in, the first 19 years of a life packed into a minute and 30 seconds. But we have a lot of ground to cover, and I thought it was important to give you a little background about how this strange little dream began. For the next 70 minutes or so, broadcasting from my studio here in Venice, California, I want to tell you a story. It's about a worldwide hit, my fall from grace, a musical 30 years in the making that to this day has not been seen nor heard, but was responsible for opening the gateway to what I'll call my resurrection, which was helped along by a Disney movie and a big-selling band. But let's pick the story up now in the year 1978, 6 years after I recorded my first album. I moved from the East Coast to Los Angeles that year on the promise that I would have a gig opening up to the folk duo Seals and Crofts.
Summer breeze makes me feel fine, blowing through the jasmine in my mind.
I toured for a month as their support act, only to return to LA without any real prospects. I mean, I was broke. Some musician friends of mine told me about a restaurant in Santa Monica hiring musicians as waiters and waitresses. It was called the Great American Food and Beverage Company. But they said you have to audition for the job. So I did, reluctantly. And when I landed the gig, I found myself on my first day lined up in the kitchen, shoulder to shoulder with my comrades, dressed in our required uniforms of knickers, high stockings, a hat, and a vest. Not quite like that, but close. We were standing there listening to our coked-up manager rant about the rules and regulations. The kitchen door flies open, and in strolls this older hippie, dressed like us, who casually walks by, grabs a time card, punches in on the clock, and joins me at the end of the line. I look over at him, and I smile, and I turn back to resume listening to our manager's rant when it dawns on me. "Wait a minute," I said to myself. "I know this guy." I look back at him, and I see him smiling back at me, and that's when it hits me. Holy shit. This is Peter Tork of the Monkees. Wait, what?
Here we come, walk down the street. We get funniest looks from everyone we meet.
For those of you who aren't old enough to appreciate the impact of that statement, the Monkees were sometimes called the American Beatles. They had a hit TV show in the late 60s and were beloved around the world. I got to know Peter as he waited on tables and I bust the slop. Together, we all performed for the patrons of the restaurant. Between shifts, he shared with me stories about his rise to fame and fortune and his fall from grace. He was humble, reflective, and a beautiful spirit. And maybe what I took away with me from this experience of working at this restaurant and meeting Peter, his struggle, his resilience, his humility, perhaps played a small part in preparing me for what I was about to experience. For it wasn't long after that that this song took me on my own roller coaster ride.
Last night I had the strangest dream. I sailed away to China.
So, as I said, I signed my first record deal when I was 19. Stride hit 10 years later. So for those of you keeping score, I was a 10-year overnight success. I was signed by renowned record executive Clive Davis to his label, Arista Records. Clive built his reputation working with artists such as Janis Joplin.
Sly and the Family Stone. The Boss, Bruce Springsteen. Whitney Houston. The inimitable Aretha Franklin. And Simon and Garfunkel, just to name a few.
Clive had a theory. He sat me down and told me in order for a pop artist to sell albums, they need to have three hit singles. Now, he had signed me as a singer-songwriter, and I naively thought an artist gets signed, you record your album, and the label releases and promotes that album. Yeah, right. But that's not how things went down. Mm-mm. For the next 2 years, I was relegated to writing and submitting one song after another. And believe me when I tell you, it was a turkey shoot. Every single song I was submitting to him was shot down. Not a hit, not a hit, not a hit, not a hit. So toward the end of the two-year period, I was sitting in my little West Hollywood flat, in my little West Hollywood studio, sitting at my little West Hollywood keyboard, and this song just pours out of me. It was a concoction of frustration and inspiration. The frustration of being a musical purgatory at the label and not making any headway, and the inspiration was what was happening on the music scene at that point in time. Because it was the early 80s, and New Wave had just come onto the scene, and all the rules were being broken stylistically.
Sweet dreams are made of this. Really the world. Do you really want to hurt me?
You come from a land down under. Oh, yeah.
Oh, she ran in science.
She blinded me with science.
Lyrically, musically, everything had changed practically overnight. And I was lit up about that. So this strange little song pours out of me in about, I'd say 30 minutes. And there's a point in the song where I'm speaking directly to Clive. In the bridge, I say, "Never let another girl like you work me over. Never let another girl like you drag me under. If I meet another girl like you, I will tell her. Never want another girl like you have to say. Ain't nothing gonna break my stride." And I was talking about Clive. We went off and made what became the record Break My Stride without any support from Clive's label. See, by this time, he had stopped the flow of all funding, so we made a deal to take the graveyard shift at a little studio in Hollywood. I, along with my production team, gathered in the wee hours of the night. We're ringing friends up, telling them, "There's a party down at Pasha Studios, come on over." And they all sang on the back end of the record. We were also very, very high, and it was a lot of fun. So now, we had this record of Break My Stride and submitted that along with a few other songs we had recorded to the label, thinking this was going to blow the doors off the barn and we'd be off to the races. It's now Christmas, and I hadn't heard anything from the label, so I decided I was going to take matters into my own hands. I rang up the label, and I got the head of A&R on the phone. And that picture should give you an idea of what I was dealing with. And for those of you who don't know what A&R means, it stands for Artist and Repertoire. These were the men and women who were responsible for helping recording artists like myself with everything from choice of songs, marketing, etc. And I said, "Hey, what's going on? We submitted all this new material, and we haven't heard a word from you people." And he said, "You haven't heard from Clive?" I said, "No." And I hear him scrambling across his desk to locate what we call a cassette. It was this tiny little format, and that's how all the musicians in those days submitted their music. Clive, historically, would write his little comments on little pieces of paper and paste them to the cassette to catalog his comments for his A&R staff, so everyone was on the same page and in lockstep with the old man. So this guy finds my cassette and goes down the list of songs from Clive's notes. This song, not a hit. That song, not a hit. Not a hit, not a hit, not a hit. He doesn't mention Break My Stride. And I say, "Forget about all those other songs. What about Break My Stride?" And he says, "Break My Stride, Break My Stride." And he reads Clive's note. Interesting tune, not a hit. And something snaps in my brain at that point, and I went on autopilot, and I heard myself say to him, "Listen, If you can't hear this, there's nothing more I can do for you guys, and I think it'd be best if you just let me off the label. And no sooner did I hang up the phone before the label's lawyer was calling me to say, I understand you want off the label. And I said, no, I'd like you people to put my music out. And he said, I'm sorry, Matthew, that's just not going to happen. And wouldn't you know it, I was on the street. Now, we really didn't know what the hell was going to happen at that point. We owned the master, and as I said, the label hadn't paid for it, so we were free to walk with the recordings of Stride and a few others. My manager at the time started shopping the records, and I wound up signing to a company owned and run by a powerful but controversial shady character. This guy was the number one independent radio promoter in the music industry. And if you were Michael Jackson or any of the biggest names in the record business, you had to go through him to get to radio. So, just to set the scene, I've changed some names of the diabolical and the innocent in my storytelling to protect the innocent from the diabolical. So let's just call him the Godfather. I was taken up to the Godfather's offices in Hollywood and introduced to him, and he had only one thing to say to me. Hey kid, don't worry about a thing. And about 6 months later, Stride was a worldwide hit.
Welcome back, sir. Nice to see you again, Matthew. For you folks who can see a monitor, introduce the new band member.
Oh, my new band member. Can you see him? Oh, there he is. That's Zachary Harrison, Ian Wilder, and his mother, Susan.
Isn't he? Look at him go. He is the cutest little rascal. He's got a full head of hair.
He should.
You know, I want to find out, we were talking about with the gal over there who wants to be an actress. You had a lot of success last year. Were you ever the least bit concerned about what you do as a follow-up or how you follow success?
Yeah, it's a lot of pressure. We had a time thing that we had to worry about and making sure that we were out and staying in the public eye.
You traveled all over the world, didn't you?
All over the world, yeah. We had Break My Stride went into the top five in every market it was released in.
Okay, so Stride is now a worldwide hit. I'm traveling the world promoting my album, I Don't Speak the Language. And as you saw in the clip, my first child, Zachary, was born, and my wife and I are still living in our little flat in West Hollywood. I've yet to see the real fruits of my labor. The telephone rings one afternoon, and it's my manager calling to say the Godfather has asked us to pay him a visit at his restaurant on Sunset Boulevard. And I say, oh, must be a victory dinner. And my manager says, yeah, sure, but if the subject of publishing comes up, just so we have our story straight, there's nothing left to go around. And I think I should tell you, for those of you who aren't familiar with the term publishing, that a song is split in two parts, the writer's share and the publisher's share, 50-50. And it's typical that any shares that are negotiated away, usually the publisher's portion, that's when record companies or other people along the way will take a percentage of a song and they get to make money too. So my manager and I arrive at the restaurant. It's a dimly lit affair. We see the Godfather sitting alone in his booth in the middle of the room. And as we approach, we notice three men sitting in the corner. And my manager says, "Hey, what's up with those three guys over there? You look nervous." And the Godfather says, "Well, those guys, they're the feds. They've been following me all day." And I'm thinking, great. We sit down, and before we even order drinks, the Godfather says, "Kid, I need a piece of the publishing." Well, that was my cue. I say to the Godfather, "Unfortunately, the publishing is all spoken for, not enough left to go around." So he says to me, "Okay, I understand. Let's say on your next record, you're lucky if you have two or three good songs. Why don't you just put a few of my songs on your next record?" Well, now you have to remember, I just come from the Clive Davis School of Hard Knocks. And before I could engage my brain, I heard myself saying, "Let's get one thing straight, right here and right now. No one tells me what to cut." I shocked myself, but before I knew it, the Godfather was reaching across the table to grab my throat, shouting, "I gave you a fucking hit record." And I said, "Hey, I gave you a fucking hit record." My manager is now between the two of us trying to keep the Godfather from strangling me, and I couldn't believe my own brass balls. I tried to cool him down, explaining, listen, my wife and newborn child are living in a tiny little flat in West Hollywood, and we haven't seen a nickel from this music. So why don't you let me have a little taste before you ask me for a little piece?" Well, suffice it to say, meeting was over, no dinner, no drinks. And when we got to the car and headed for home, my manager says to me, "You were great in there tonight." I said, "Oh, you think so, huh?" He said, "Yeah, the Godfather respected you for standing up to him in there." And I said, "You mark my words, my career ended in there tonight." And unfortunately, my prediction was fairly accurate. I went on to make a follow-up album called Bouncing Off the Walls, but it wasn't long after that that my album and my career went bouncing off the rails, and the Godfather was sentenced to 50 months in jail for extortion and money laundering. And as for me, it was back to basics. I have to admit, I was knocked back on my heels by the whiplash of pop stardom and what felt like sudden and certain death of an artist's career. I was a new father, but my first marriage came apart, and I was now couch surfing trying to regain some equilibrium. It was a tough period, more than a decade in the wilderness. I signed on as a staff writer at a publishing company and began writing and pitching songs, hoping to place them with other recording artists. And through this process, I began sharpening my skills as a record producer. My mother, an opera singer and graduate of New York's Juilliard School of Music, gave me a book to read called Cry to Heaven, a novel by renowned author Anne Rice. Anne, for those of you who aren't familiar, was the author of a series of vampire novels. One of her most famous titles was Interview with a Vampire. Cry to Heaven takes place in 18th century Italy, an historical novel about children who were castrated and cultivated to sing as male sopranos, some of which went on to become the opera stars, the rock stars of their day. So while I was working hard at writing pop songs for other artists, trying to keep my head screwed on straight, I was submerged in this book and inspired to write the score to Cry to Heaven. That year, we had a tragedy in our family. We lost one of our children in a terrible accident, leaving us all devastated. In my grief, I found myself writing the first song of the score as a requiem for this lost child of ours.
This world, a child of many ones. the spirit home. Cry unto heaven a bittersweet surrender. God save this child and protect his soul. Mother, Father, this cry to heaven, this simple melody plays out its part. Mother, Father, you will remember this cry to heaven that comes from my heart. Sweet surrender, cry to heaven, sweet surrender.
The song, as I said, grew into a score and eventually workshopped for its very first time as a work in progress at a Canadian musical theater festival in Toronto. I was now married to my second wife, Tamara. My second son, Grayson, had just been born, so we packed up the whole family and headed to Toronto in the dead of winter. Cry to Heaven was one of eight musicals presented that season and, simply put, a miserable failure. I was crushed. After all that effort, we returned to LA and I thought, well, that's done and dusted, and planned to bury the musical in a drawer somewhere and forget about the whole idea of being a Broadway composer. But one day, my phone rings and it's Disney ringing me up to chat about taking a meeting. Apparently, they had scouts attending the festival and saw something they liked about my writing, so they asked me if I would meet with them. When we met, they said, "We don't have a specific project for you at the moment, but we certainly like to work with you and wish to know if you'd be interested in signing a development deal." What was I going to say? No. I jumped at the opportunity, and the day I inked the deal, I was introduced to the head of Disney's feature animation department, Tom Schumacher. Tom congratulated me when I sat down to meet with him, and I thanked him. And he said, "I don't think you understand." I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "You see, we had to recently let go of a composer who was working on a project for us, and you're the replacement. It's called Mulan." I thought, "What's a Mulan?" So Tom said, "You'll be taken from this office to your first meeting for the film." And as I was being escorted out of his office, Tom shouts after me, "And Matthew, just remember one thing. You're paid to have an opinion." Okay. I was then brought to a big conference room filled with about 20 to 25 people, the writing team, the two directors, the producer, and my blind date for the next 4 years, lyricist David Zippel. My head was spinning. As I took my place amongst them, I noticed a series of sketches mounted on the walls covering the circumference of the room. These were the drawings depicting the story of Mulan. It was my and David's job that day to spot the film. In other words, choose the moments we thought would be best to musicalize. And the first moment we chose to write was Mulan's reflection. So this being our very first song, David and I dug in and poured everything we had into this first piece. When we finished, we presented the song to the creative team. It was a very big deal for us, nerve-wracking. I had to stand in front of all these people for the first time to pitch our song and sell the moment. So I'm going to play for you what they heard that day. This is the very first version of Reflection that no one has ever heard before. Look at me, I can almost pass for a China doll.
and a perfect daughter. Can it be? I must always play this part. Now I see, if I learn each rule, I can fool them all. But I cannot fool my heart. Why does my reflection lie? Who's that stranger staring back at me? Why, no matter how I try, am I so at odds with who I see? Anyone who looked would say, what a perfect bride. When will my reflection match who I am inside?
The song was well received, and the team agreed it was time to present it to Michael Eisner, the president of the Disney Empire. So we all loaded into the elevators and shuttled down to the first floor of the Disney Animation Building, to the private movie theater, where I was to meet Mr. Eisner for the very first time. We all take our seats. Eisner walks in, the theater lights go down, and the curtain goes up. The sketches of Mulan's reflection come to life in a series of drawings as the demo of the song plays through. When the scene finishes, the lights come up and the curtain falls. Everyone looks to Eisner for his reaction. He asks to hear the song again, and we all sit and listen and watch him as he sits with his eyes closed listening for the second time. When the song is over, without a word, Michael gets up from his seat and proceeds to cross the aisle to find his place across from me. He had so many other people he could have chosen to sit across from, but I guess I was the lucky one. And he says to me, "You and I have never met, so this is going to be a difficult conversation." And I thought, uh-oh. And he leans in and he says, "Now, I'm not a musician, so I can't speak to you in musical terms. I can only tell you about how the song made me feel as I was listening." "Okay." He continued, "When the song began, I thought to myself, this is going to be something very special." And I thought, that doesn't sound so bad. But, he said, when it got to the chorus, and then he interrupted himself, "Listen, Matthew, this is the first song you've written for this score, and it has to stand the test of time. It'll be the song that will be played over the next 4 years over and over again, and it needs to break the glass ceiling." And when it got to the chorus, I have to say, it just didn't do that for me. "You need to break the glass ceiling." End of meeting. What did he mean, break the glass ceiling? I returned to my little house in the valley, bent and determined to break the code. I worked the rest of that day and into the night thinking, okay, the song begins in the key of A, and I modulate to the key of C mid-verse. I like all that. But then in the original chorus, I wrote in the key of F. "When will my reflection lie?" That had to change. So I decided I needed to stay in the modulated key of C. So the melody was going to stay elevated and write a melody that no human being, unless it was a diva, would be able to interpret. And this is what I came up with.
When will my reflection shine?
I was excited. This was a time before MP3s in the digital age, so I rang up David Zippel and Chris Montan, Disney's music executive, and I asked them to come to my house that morning. I played them my new chorus, my solution to the problem, and waited to see their reaction. They looked at one another and said, "By Jove, my boy, I think you've done it." And as I recall, David took to rewriting the original chorus lyrics on the spot to fit the new melody. And later that day, I hastily recorded a demo of the song with me singing. And not very well, I thought. It's a melody built for a diva, and as I said, I'm no diva. Well, you know that. But I was off to London the next day and wanted to show the producer of Mulan the song that I had rewritten. I messengered the demo over to her that evening, along with the strict instructions not to let anyone hear it till I returned from England. England? Now, England, you may say. Why was Wilder going to England? My wife and I had been invited by Robert Stigwood to his estate on the Isle of Wight, and it was called Barton Manor, and we were there to chat about collaborating with him on a new production of, wait for it, Cry to Heaven. Who, pray tell, is Robert Stigwood, you may ask? Well, Robert, or Stiggy as we used to call him, was the great rock impresario who stepped in to manage the Beatles for a short while after Brian Epstein died. He managed Cream, found the Bee Gees, founded RSO Records, put Andrew Lloyd Webber on the map with Jesus Christ Superstar, produced Saturday Night Fever, Grease. The list is endless. This was the man who said he had found his next Andrew Lloyd Webber, and who was I to argue, and wanted to produce Cry to Heaven in the West End. So he flew us first class to Heathrow, then private helicoptered us to the Isle of Wight, and as we're landing in Stiggy's private vineyard, I can see him from the helicopter racing to meet us with a regalia of golf carts and butlers dressed in tails hanging on for dear life. We land, and Robert invites us for a bite of lunch where he proceeds to polish off a pitcher of Pimm's, all the while nursing a liter of ale, and when the beer reaches an inch from the bottom of the glass, a butler who is standing behind him is there at the ready with a fresh full glass to replenish Robert's supply. After lunch, Robert says, "My darlings, you must be exhausted after your long flight. Why don't you retire to your chambers for a nap, and I'll wake you for dinner." So we were shown to our suite. Tamara and I drew the heavy drapes closed and fell into a deep, deep sleep, only to be awakened by the sound of breaking glass and the blaring soundtrack of Cry to Heaven. We both sit bolt upright in bed, and Tam, still half asleep and disoriented, says, "Why are you playing the music so loud?" And I said, "Me? That isn't me." I walk over to the window, pull back the drapes to find the window is broken, and I see Robert down in the courtyard laughing.
Come down, children, it's time for dinner."
And like a fiendish little boy, he'd been throwing rocks up at our window and blasting my music to wake us. Robert had a devilish sense of humor, and he was outrageous fun. And it was all we could do to keep up with his pace for the next 4 days. Drinking, hiking, uproarious chats in the wee hours of the morning, all about Cry to Heaven. At the end of our stay, as a present for my wife's birthday, Stiggy puts us up at the Dorchester in London the night prior to our return to the States. As we were checking into our suite, the phone was ringing. When I picked up the receiver, a voice on the other end says, "Matthew Wilder, please hold for Michael Eisner." My wife says, "Who is it?" And I whisper, "It's Michael Eisner." "How did he know that we're..." "I don't know." "Hello, Matthew?" "Yes." "Congratulations, you broke the glass ceiling." I said, "Excuse me?" And Eisner is kind of laughing, says, "You broke the glass ceiling, my boy. Congratulations." "I'm sorry, what are we talking about here?" He said, "I heard the song Reflection, and you did exactly what I asked you to do." I said, "Let me get this straight. Pam Coates, the producer, against my wishes, went and played you the demo? And he said, yeah. And I laughed and thought, damn that woman, and God bless her. So I passed the test. We were off to the races for the next 4 years, and we're still running the race 2 decades later.
Look at me. I will never pass for a perfect bride or a perfect daughter. Can it be? I'm not meant to play this part. Now I see that if I were truly to be myself, I would break my family's heart.
So between 94 and 98, while I was working on the score for Mulan and Cry to Heaven, there was an unexpected invitation added to my workload. After firing 3 previous producers for their second album, I stepped in to produce my first album for a band. That's Just a Girl from Tragic Kingdom by No Doubt, with lead singer Gwen Stefani. It took us 1.5 years to make that album, and because the previous producers had been sacked, by the time I came along, there was a pretty volatile and hostile vibe in the room. Gwen's brother, Eric, was the founding member of the band, and at the time we met, the only songwriter. He was strongly influenced by his heroes, the bands Madness and The Specials. The style was called ska, and Gwen, well, she was just the singer. So I suggested that Gwen should step in and try writing with some of the other band members, just to see if we couldn't bring her voice forward and change things up a bit. I used references of the 70s group Blondie as an example of a new model they could shoot for. Over the course of that 1.5 years, the songs got stronger and stronger, and the last months of our process was when some of the best material was realized, including 5 songs off the album that became hit singles. Songs like Just a Girl and Don't Speak.
You and me, I can see us dying, aren't we?
Don't speak, I know just what you're saying, so please.
Don't speak, I know what you're thinking, and that I'll need your
tension, the conflict depicted in that video was real. Art imitating life, imitating art. Eric, who was disillusioned and upset about having lost control of his vision for the band, quit halfway through the recording of the album. So now it's just down to Gwen and the three boys. After a year and a half of recording, after all that time and effort, when we handed in the album, the record label, well, what do you know, wanted to drop the band and shelve the record. But in the 11th hour, two people who had a small label that was having some success with a band called Bush heard my rough mixes and insisted they release Tragic Kingdom and promote it. So the larger label gives it to the smaller label, and the smaller label turns it in to a massive hit. Sound familiar? Label doesn't believe in record. Record is sold to another label. Beginning to notice a pattern here? After 5 hit singles and over 20 million albums sold, we're off to the Grammys. So here I am. Mulan is completed. It has an Oscar nomination for its music, and Tragic Kingdom is nominated for 4 Grammy Awards, Best Song by a Band or Duo, Best Song for Don't Speak, Album of the Year, and Producer of the Year. My wife and I fly to New York for the ceremonies. Now, every year, traditionally, Clive Davis hosts a celebratory event the night before the awards, his pre-Grammy gala, and I'm invited. The night of the gala, my wife and I are sitting at a big table surrounded by the biggest names in the industry, waiting for the festivities to begin, when Gwen Stefani walks in and sits down between us, looking exhausted and frayed. They had dragged her off the road without her bandmates, and because she is not used to singing night after night songs like Just a Girl, her voice was shot. To keep her afloat, they've been shooting her vocal cords with steroids. She tells us of all the infighting and jealousy between her and the boys. And to add insult to injury, the two record labels are suing one another for the rights to the band and the massive album. So here we are, now sitting in between the two warring record labels, one very unhappy recording star, and Clive Davis, the man who rejected Break My Stride, is up on the stage introducing Puff Daddy, who performs his version of Break My Stride.
I get the feeling sometimes to make me wonder why you wanna take us under.
Why you wanna take us under?
I get the feeling sometimes to make me wonder why you wanna take us under.
Why you wanna take us under?
Can't nobody take my pride. Can't nobody hold me down. Oh no, I got to keep on moving. Broken glass everywhere. If it ain't about no money, Puff, I just don't.
Now, I haven't seen Clive since he booted me off his label 16 years prior. 16 years. After the speeches and performances at the end of the festivities, Clive is making his way across the crowded room, saying hello to all the celebrities, and he's headed straight for me. And I'm thinking, how am I going to handle this? Do I take the high road? Do I take the low road? What do you say to a man who kept you in musical purgatory all those years ago? We're now nose to nose. I look at him, he looks at me, and there's a which way is this thing gonna go kind of moment. And then I throw my arms around him and whisper in his ear, it's like coming home. And that little gesture, I suppose, rekindled that special little spark Clive and I have always had, and he invites me to produce a song I had written for Kelly Clarkson. Kelly, you may remember, was the very first winner of American Idol, and this was to be her album debut on the man's label, Arista Records.
He drowns in his dreams, an exquisite extreme, I know. He's as damned as he seems, and more heaven than a heart could hold. And if I try to save him, my whole world could cave in. Just ain't right, just ain't right.
Oh, and I don't know, I don't know what he's after, but he's so beautiful, he's such a beautiful disaster. And if I could hold on through the tears and the laughter, would it be beautiful or just a beautiful disaster?
Now, decades later, after working with a whole range of artists, producing, mentoring new talent, writing film and theater scores, there's been a ripple in the universe. An anomaly, I might even say. Time folding back onto itself. Could have knocked me over with a feather when my brother rings me up to tell me there's a Google alert about Break My Stride blowing up a TikTok and going viral. My reaction? I shrugged. TikTok, I'm ashamed to admit, was not an app on my phone and certainly not in my realm of day-to-day awareness. For those of you who aren't aware, hard to believe at this late date, but I'll go the extra mile, TikTok is an app that allows users to create 15 to 60 second dance and lip sync videos. Now, I was on my way to Budapest to rendezvous with my older son, Zachary, who was performing in an opera, when my brother hit me to what was happening. And by the time I landed in Europe, Stride had gone viral and I was a rock star all over again. I'm kidding, of course, but Sony, the press were now ringing me up and a whole new generation had either rediscovered or was embracing this song for the very first time, and has had over 185 million views and 500,000 videos on TikTok alone. It was an odd sensation walking the streets of Budapest and having high school students pointing at me, and I'm not exaggerating. Stride never did have a video back in the 80s, so I commissioned the director when I got home of an animated short film I scored this past year called The Pig on the Hill, to have his main character dance to the song. Nothing gonna break my stride, nobody gonna slow me down. Oh no, no, I got to keep on moving. Ain't nothing gonna break my stride, I'm running and I won't touch ground. Oh no, I got to keep on moving. But that's not all. In case you've been living in a cave in the Himalayas, you're probably aware that Disney has made a $250 million live-action remake of the 1998 animated feature Mulan. When the new version was about 80% complete, Disney had shown an earlier cut of the film to test audiences and were taken aback by their adverse reaction to the film not incorporating any of the songs from the original. So Disney came a-calling and asked David Zippel and I to retrofit some of the songs to possibly incorporate as montages in the film. This is one example of the new approach I took with I'll Make a Man Out of You.
Let's get down to business. You unworthy ones. Did they send me?
They didn't go for it. We worked hard to get our movie songs into the movie, but it just wasn't working. But what they did do as a way to tie the two movie versions together was take three musical themes from the music I had written and weave them into the score, the most prominent of which is Reflection.
This time he will not return. Loyal, brave, and true. It is my duty to protect my family.
Ancestors, please protect her.
What is your name, soldier?
Hua Jun, Commander, son of Hua Zhou.
We're going to make men out of every single one of you. Close the gate!
The spirit is evident, but something holds you back.
When they find out who you are, they will show you no mercy. I'm Hua Mulan. I will bring honor to us all.
This next segment features my two sons, Grayson and Zachary. I'm so proud to say they are both wonderful artists in their own right. Grayson, my younger son, is a fashion photographer by day, but a muso at heart. And Zachary, the older one, is a Baroque opera tenor who lives in Paris and tours the world when we're not in lockdown. I asked them each to choose a song from my catalog that we could collaborate on and present together. Grayson chose to interpret a song I wrote for the Lizzie McGuire movie in 2003. It's called What Dreams Are Made Of. Gray told me this song meant a lot to him as he was growing up. Zachary chose to sing Handful of Rain from my score To Cry to Heaven. So allow me to introduce the two loves of my life, Grayson Patrick and Zachary Harrison Ian Wilder.
Have you ever seen such a beautiful night? I could almost kiss the stars for shining so bright. When I see you smiling, I go, oh, oh, oh. I would never want to miss this, 'cause in my heart I know what this is. This is what dreams are made of. This is what dreams are made of. I've got somewhere I belong. Got somebody to love. This is what dreams are made of. Have you ever wondered what life is about? You can search the world and never figure it out. You don't have to sail the ocean. No, no, no. Happiness is no mystery. It's here and now. It's you and me, yeah. This is what dreams are made of. This is what dreams are made of. This is what dreams, dreams. This is what dreams are made of. That were too small to catch all the rainfall, lost heart, lost soul was I saw my reflection, every imperfection, as heaven shed tears to cry. I saw a boy who was lost and
one final piece of music. It's a song called Freaks of Nature. It's the culmination, the sum of all that I've learned and experienced through my life as a father, a musician, and simply put, a human being. Make of it what you will, but I poured everything of myself into this song. Thank you for taking time out of your lives to spend time with me. Please stay safe, stay healthy, and now, Freaks of Nature.
Just and I'm in a message I feel tears me apart now. Don't break my heart now. Just show me some love, 'cause I really could use it.